system.
You two are married for a long time now?
No.
You're a great husband wife team.
A great friend team.
I thought we were married.
I'm sorry. Well, it's Utah. Things are different here. Yeah.
So how is the collaboration start between the two of you?
Well, I mean, we've been friends for a while, and we had always had conversations about the topic matter. And James had the idea initially, and we just started talking about it a lot, and then we kind of created the characters of Kate and Charlie and the story, and then the writing process was great because James was actually living in Virginia at the time because his real wife was living there, and so he and I would correspond through emails when he was in town. We would get together and watch movies and write, but a lot of it would be James writing an amount of pages, I'm writing an amount of pages, and we're sending them back and forth. But it was so easy and pleasurable writing with James.
In spite of this having been in wrong cities?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think the thing that, for me, a lot of what served is Susan, I think, was an inspiration to me. You know, like her own honesty and vulnerability and openness with her own life and the stories that she's had in sobriety, I found very moving, but also very funny. I mean, I have a lot of ridiculous stories of dumb things I did when I was drunk. Hers top mine by a mile, and pretty much everyone I know, and usually skate a fine line between, you know, hilarious and heartbreaking, which I think most addiction stories do, but seldom when they're depicted in films. Usually they're tragic, you feel sorry for the character, you feel awful, you never want to be there, and you can't relate. And we wanted to do a story that spoke to us, spoke to people that we knew, and was about love at its core and a relationship, and where the dominant aspect of the story was not alcoholism. It was part of their lives, but it's really about a coming of age story for a woman and about her marriage.
So I'm sure it's healthy for you theoretically to be doing this. Is it strange for you to be in this position where now you're?
It is strange for me a bit. It was funny last night at the party before the screening. I was actually handed a drink that had alcohol in it, and I didn't know it had alcohol in it, and I, you know, almost drank it. And just thought, like, well, that would be the worst time to realize, like, right before the movie that I co-wrote, you know, about alcoholism premieres. So I didn't, which is good. But yeah, I mean, at first I wasn't sure if I wanted to be open and say, you know, that I am sober and that there are elements from my own life in this. And then I thought, you know what, who cares? Like, I don't care if people are going to judge me on that. I think it brings more truth to the story, and but yeah, it is strange because a couple of the things in the movie's not autobiographical at all. It's a fictional story, but a couple of the, you know, scenes are things that happen to me in real life. So seeing that, you know, like on the big screen is really strange. Like, oh, that actually happened, and that's actually pretty close to how it happened.
Good job. So is it, one of the things that's striking about the movie to me is that she is, or they both really, are kind of right on that borderline, not, you know, even though she has a couple experiences that are extreme, she's kind of living, she's a functional alcoholic, I guess, as is he, to whatever degree. Was that a choice you guys made early on to not take her to extremes or him?
Yeah, I mean, there's that idea that sometimes the greatest tragedy is a tragedy nearly averted. I mean, I think through either like the tropes of films that deal with, you know, alcohol or drug abuse, we know where these stories can go. And I think we sort of played out in our conversations every plot turn that it could, yes, she could drive drunk, she could kill someone, yes, she could do all these things. And I think hopefully the film is knowing enough and the audience trusts the film enough that we may be afraid, we the audience early on, that it's going to go there, but it doesn't, because it's a film that's much more warm and humane and is not really about the extremes of it, because frankly, that would be tired. I mean, those stories have been, stories about alcohol have been told since, you know, in film since Prohibition, you know? So, I mean, we've done that. We wanted to do something that was new and that was a hangout movie, where you actually enjoy the time with them and you don't want to get away from them.
And I mean, something that was really important to me, like in my own experience, when I look at getting sober and the point that I decided to get sober, you know, I didn't really hit a bottom. I initially got sober when I was only 18, then relapsed when I was 21, and then took a few years of trying and failing and trying and failing. Mm-hmm. But to me, it was like I would hit a bottom and then I would adapt and that would just be my life. And then right. I'd hit another bottom and adapt and that'd be my life. And I think that's extremely common. And, you know, one person watching this film could be like, she's not that bad at all. And someone else could be like, oh my God, that's horrible, you know, because I think it really is your lifestyle and what you're used to. And there's this sort of obvious, you know, like depictions of people doing terrible, horrible things where it's so clear that they have a problem and they're, you know, a bad person because of it. But with Kate, she's not a bad person, you know, and neither is Charlie. They're both really good people that, you know, and with Charlie, I don't even know if he's an alcoholic. Yeah. He might be, he might not be. It's up for him to decide, you know?
Yeah, I mean, the film purposely passes no moral judgment on how they live their lives. I mean, I have a lot of friends, including married friends, who, by the standards of this film, if one was going to call them alcoholics, my friends would certainly be alcoholics. And I think they've kind of phased, they're in that weird in-between phase where they've committed themselves to someone, they've partnered up, they haven't had kids yet, so their life is still comic. It's once they have kids and drunks are raising kids, it becomes a lot less funny, certainly for the kids. So, I mean...
Sequel,
yeah. But I mean, and I don't know if that's the movie that necessarily, I don't know, we would want to live in. And I don't think, like, we weren't trying to make a social issue movie. I think those tend to be pretty boring and flat, and the issue becomes the thing that the movie's about. And this isn't a PSA. You know, it's a story, it's a study of a relationship, it's a study of a character.
And with AA, we didn't want it to be, you know, in AA they say like attraction rather than promotion. We didn't want this to be something that promoted AA. We felt like it was a story that was sort of impossible to tell without having that element in there and showing those characters. But at the same time, we want to be objective towards it. Like, you know, whatever people's feelings are about AA, we don't want to be, you know, pro or con. Just, it's there, you know, we just want to show it.
Reminded me of this year, the movie Shame coming out. And, you know, there are a lot of critics who seem to feel that he's just a good-looking guy getting laid a lot.
Yeah.
And there's no problem. So, well, you know, what's the problem with this movie? Why are they, and it's interesting, that line that people just have their own idea of what the reality is.
Yeah, and I mean, I think you could replace alcohol with a lot of things in this story. I mean, this is an all-consuming love for this couple. They're certainly in love. They certainly work when they're drunk, but it's they're also probably codependent. They're also enablers to each other's worst behavior. And they probably, you know, I mean... You could, there's a lot of things that it could be. There is a major life change. You could replace it with someone being like, I need to go back to school. I need to have a child now. I need to do anything. When you introduce or remove an element that's been the sort of the thing, the tie that's binding a relationship, things shift.
Yeah.
And the romance in this relationship changes. And it's really about that struggle. Two people who love each other, who want to be supportive, but they're just emotionally stunted. I mean, they're pushing 30. They're living like they're 18 or 19. And I think that speaks actually to a lot of people our age. I have a lot of friends who are 30 that live with their parents. So.
And I think so many people in our generation are comfortable with being in a rut, you know, and want to stay in a rut and don't see it as a rut. And, you know, if you're in a partnership where you're both in a rut and one of the people decides, like, no, I'm moving forward now, that's extremely difficult for both people because now they're on completely different paths. And you either change together or one of you changes and the other doesn't.
And kind of more thematically where the movie is than just an alcohol.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, without question.
So who brought in the pages in the first time that said peeing in bed?
Who was peeing in bed?
Let's open the movie with peeing in
bed. Yeah, I mean, our big set pieces, right? We do have like public urination, we have peeing in bed, we have vomiting. There was actually another vomiting scene which was cut. I don't know, I think it was a good
bodily function.
I think we like physical and bodily function humor, but it also felt, I mean, listen, everyone that's drunk has pissed themselves, probably, maybe, and puked somewhere. So I don't think there's anything shocking. I just think it's part of the life. And I think it's actually, I think we identify with characters, we relate to them, not when they're at their best, but actually when they're at their worst or the most embarrassing, you know? And it's, and I think, you know, we went out of our way to humanize Mary's character, Kate. And I mean, Mary is, in life, a stunningly beautiful woman. And, you know, I think, you know, we wanted to do everything we could to make her as relatable as possible.
So you brought her down? Is that her?
I wouldn't say we brought her down. I mean, I think it starts from her. You know, it doesn't... Right. Again, there's all kinds of otherness, right? Whether it's someone who... I mean, someone who is stunningly beautiful, someone who, you know, questions of authorship. Can a white person tell a black person's story? Can it, things like that, you go on and on. I mean, we wanted to depict this honestly and allow the character to be, you know, the audience to feel like they had a surrogate in her. I'm not making judgments on people pissing the bed. It happens to adults too. Yeah.
And getting Mary, was that a easy process? Was that a slam dunk?
It wasn't a slam dunk. It was a coup. I mean, it was. I've been a big fan of hers, as you know, with all the actors in it. She had. I mean, I knew her work probably best from Scott Pilgrim.
Right.
And I think. I mean, I really like the film, but I do think that she is this strong core at the film. I mean, she's a character. She is the object of romantic desire that is something of a Mona Lisa throughout that film. She's stoic still, is not allowed to smile. I had no idea if that's what she was like. I assumed she was an actor. She had a lot of range, and when I met her, I was blown away. You know, I mean, she has a real strength about her, which I think was really important for the part, because I think so often women, especially the drunk girl, they're made to seem weak or shrill, and the audience feels pity. And when you feel pity for a character, it's a pretty miserable feeling. We wanted to be able to go to places with Mary and allow the audience, you know, to travel with her and not feel sorry for her and track with her. So I felt very lucky to get Mary for the part.
And what process did you go through with her as you got towards the production?
We started working, over probably about 6 weeks out. I mean, we were doing a lot of very actorly work. She spent a lot of time with people who are sober, like Susan, like other friends of ours. We did spend time in AA meetings. And then there was a lot of work on just ridiculous sense memory things about what it is to feel drunk, you know? So there was that. But a lot of conversations, really. I mean, that's really what it was identifying in her own life, what were the addictions, what were the things where she felt powerless, what were the things where she felt codependent, and finding that emotional thread for her. I mean, for her, she's not an alcoholic, so that's not going to be it for her. But we identified that for her, and she was really vulnerable and open with me. And I mean, when she arrived on set, she pretty much was the character.
So you could pretty much ruin her life with the star.
Pretty much, yes.
You know, way too much. And no, was it surprising to you that she was willing to dive in so deeply?
I don't think I would have wanted to work with her if she wasn't. I mean, it's, you know, I think there are actors who have a brand that they have to maintain, an image that they have to maintain, and they're, you know, they're great actors who maybe could go out of their comfort zone, but just don't for any number of reasons, and it's unfortunate, you know, because they could, and audiences would love to see them go there.
Right.
Mary's not that person. She is a real capital A actor who is bold and brave and willing to try anything, and I think I could have thrown anything at her and she would have gone for it. I mean, she really was, I think, the leader on set. People were inspired by her work ethic, but also by how brave she was, you know? I mean, she was hilarious and she was crazy and she was emotionally naked a lot of the time. And at times she was drunk and feral.
Right.
I mean, certainly the major fight scene with her and Aaron, there were at least two people that have seen that performance and described her as feral, and I was like, that's a beautiful way to describe it. She is. She scares the living hell out of me there, as she should, you know?
Right.
She has a real strength and range.
And Nick and Megan, was that you were just looking for the perfect couple to not be a couple one?
I'm a big, big fan of theirs, but both of theirs. I mean, it helps that they're married. I've loved Nick for a long time, and I mean, I think it's pretty amazing that he's happened to this TV role that is probably one of the definitive TV roles of our time, I think, for whether it is this sort of, I don't know, patriotic, whatever it is, naive American, or whether it's this image of masculinity, but he is a real serious actor, and I think, we have a number of TV actors in this film who are great, and I think it's really exciting to get them, to give them a part that's different than what they do, because so often, you know, a great actor, they can win Emmys, but it's really tough when that show's off the air, because they get, identified by that. But, I mean, Nick could do anything, and when we had him, it was very important to surround our main characters with people who could bring humor to the story and possess that, and that hopefully, you know, the audience isn't quite sure emotionally or tonally what film they're getting, whether it's okay to laugh. I think it's a great feeling when you're in the audience and you're a little bit nervous and uncomfortable, and you're not sure if you have permission to laugh at someone. That's the best kind of comedy. Clear punchlines aren't the funniest things to me.
I was so impressed with Megan Mullally too, because I mean, mm-hmm. when we cast her, I was delighted. I'm a huge fan of her work, but mm-hmm. you know, she normally, like the work that I know her from, Will and Grace, you know, she's really big and, you know, and out there and crazy, and that character could be played that way, and that's how I sort of imagined that it would be, and mm-hmm. then seeing it for the first time and seeing how subtle she was, and but still like this strange woman, and just she was just brilliant. I was so impressed.
Did Nick Sobriety have anything to do with him getting involved?
No.
He talks about it pretty openly. He's not really...
Yeah, we didn't talk about that at all. I mean, I think...
I didn't know until just now.
I think Nick... no, I've never actually had a conversation with him about sobriety, really, or any of his personal stuff. I mean, I think for him...
We talked to Nick on camera, much like all this,
yeah.
A few months ago
yeah.
for Emmys or whatever,
yeah.
and he completely talks about the, you know, the fact that he does the canoe thing in part
yeah.
because he needs to stay busy because he doesn't want to go back to that place. So
yeah,
it's not. No. I don't see it. I didn't mean to infringe on personal things.
No.
He does talk about it.
He's very, you know, open and honest, and pretty much. I mean, he literally took his shirt off in a photo yesterday. I mean, I think one thing that I can say that attracted him. I mean, there is a scene in the movie without giving too much away where he sort of crosses a boundary with. If you've seen the film, but crosses a boundary with Mary's character and says some inappropriate things, and the film, I think, you know, the film forgives him, Mary's character forgives him,
right.
but I think that scene, the opportunity to do that scene, to say those things, I think that really excited him. I mean, mm-hmm. Nick comes from a Chicago theater world, and I think he was almost known as Nick, the guy who would do whatever. If you need a guy to stick something up his ass, you know, and just go for it, he would. He's bold, and I think the only thing restricting him, I mean, he would have, if I'd asked him to shave his head, and
right.
it was not, you know, during Parks and Rec, like, he probably would have,
right.
you know? I mean, he's brave,
yeah.
And he wants to push the limits.
He showed up with a different mustache last night, didn't he? Or is he got goatee going now?
The goatee, the secret of the goatee in the film, it was real hair above the mouth.
Yeah.
Below was fake. It was Italian. Some Italian man gave that up. It started as this Rasputin type goatee that we kind of shaved down into what you see in the film.
Is that something you expected to be worrying about when you became a director?
I didn't, but it actually was something that I spent a lot of time. We kind of went back and forth on exactly how long that hair. I mean, Nick is someone, again, I think it's his theater background, he really wants to be a chameleon and
right.
really takes great pleasure. There are actors who it's all, I think, internal motivation, and some that really want to find the perfect glasses, the perfect shoes, the perfect hair. I think Nick is a mix of both, but he really mm-hmm. takes great relish in things like wigs and mustaches and, you know, glasses.
And had Octavia shot The Help even before she did this, or?
She had shot The Help. It hadn't come out. I mean, she was far and away my first choice. I mean, she's been, you know, great in films. I mean, I think her first role 16 years ago, and mm-hmm. she had been a scene stealer in a million things. I mean, just in the year before, I think, for me, it was like Drag Me to Hell and Dinner for Schmucks. It was like, you watch those movies, and she just pops off the screen. You see someone
right.
being honest and hilarious and strange, but it's all grounded.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, her energy is so amazing, and I was just very excited to have her play the part. So we lucked out with her, and I couldn't believe that she did it. And everything that's happened with The Help is amazing and well-deserved and way overdue, and it's just really cool for us.
Just to figure out how to balance out the poster where it says Academy Award winner. You all have to catch up with her now.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Well, we have a couple Emmy winners in the cast,
yeah.
too.
That's
yeah.
true.
Yeah. yeah, yeah,
yeah.
No, but I mean, she's cool. I mean, because, I mean, Octavia's been at it for so long. She brings no ego to it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this was a low-budget movie, and she was, you know, willing to do whatever. She's down, and she's, you know, a serious actor.
So what were your expectations when you got into, you know, you go, okay, now we have a script, now we have something we're interested in doing, let's go.
I imagined this to be, you know, it's low budget now, but I imagined that we would be making a very, very low budget movie, casting mostly friends, and, you know, maybe we'll premiere at some festival somewhere in the country, but... Oh.
Nope. Your mic just got
oh, right sorry. Really oh, sorry about that. All right.
Sorry.
But so yeah, I imagine that we'd be shooting something on a much smaller scale.
Right.
And that, you know, I can't believe the caliber of actors that we have. Everyone is so amazing, and that we're premiering. You know, that we premiered at Sundance. That has exceeded my expectations a lot. So.
Do you think they came for the script or the director or what?
100% the script, and only the pages that I wrote. Just kidding. We, I think, have really lucked out with everybody involved. I mean, when I'm so blown away by the locations that we have for this film and how, like, their house is totally how I imagined their house to look when we wrote it, you know? Like, and that house is a character, and the bars that they're in, I mean, so everyone who worked on it, I think, brought something amazing to it.
I think to give credit to Susan and to the script, I think a lot of it, the majority of it probably did start with the script, mm-hmm. and that we were approaching actors who we loved, and in some cases, there were parts that were a little bit different than what they were being offered. Right. And, you know, and when I met with them, you know, I pretty much came on my knees and was really passionate. I could tell them exactly why I thought they would be great for this part, and I really meant it. And you know, there was no bullshit. And I don't know. I'm a big fan of every actor in the film, and I do think that they bring something that's unique to who they are. But for the most part, it's things that you just haven't seen them do before. And I think, all things being equal, most actors that we love, they really are artists, and they would love to do small movies, weird movies. It's just sometimes an issue of time, paying the mortgage, and dealing with the kid who needs to go to college, and sometimes right. they just can't. But if you approach people at the right time, with the right passion and the right part and the right, you know, seriousness of intent, I it's pretty inspiring what the results can be with getting a cast like this.
So hard shoot?
No, it was a remarkably easy shoot. I mean, we, you know, not a lot of money, so we didn't have a lot of time, but it was incredibly, there's that whole time, money, quality triangle they say choose to. Uh-huh. I mean, we, you know, it was very well planned. We had great actors, the script was tight, and, you know, we had a great crew that could just run fast. It felt for a lot of the key scenes in it, the really emotional scenes, it felt like we actually did have as much time as we would have if we'd had a budget that was 10 times as big. We had a great crew, and everyone, I think, was on the same page. I think everyone felt like the value system of the story was something they wanted to be a part of. You know, they right. felt like it was a film about something that meant something, but it was fun to be on set. The humor that is in the script and that I think is in the film came across. People were laughing between takes, you know, but in scenes where people were just bawling their eyes out. So it was a blast, and it was a real gift to be able to stand by the camera and watch those actors do a scene and do things that I never could have imagined. And I'm grateful that I didn't micromanage them.
Aaron and Mary said they had just kind of snuck off and had dinner, but there wasn't really actually a lot of rehearsal on the set.
No, I mean, it was, they did have a sort of, I don't know what the term would be, it was important to me that they had sort of an actor date with me. Again, not hovering over them, creating a shadow, or stressing them out.
Waiting at the table.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you like the fish?
Exactly. No, I mean, I wanted to know, I mean, they need that chemistry, as it were, and it was important right. to me that they had it, and they both felt that they had it. I mean, after they met up, I talked to both of them and sort of wanted to get a sense of what they saw in each other, and if either of them hadn't been on the same page, I don't think I would have cast it that way. But yeah, I mean, it was a lot of conversations is what it was. I mean, it was really getting on the same, I mean, rehearsal can be great, but I think you can also suck the life out of something, and I think you can get a really plastic idea early on of exactly what the scene can be, and you suddenly inhibit it from becoming something greater. So we talked a ton about the characters and what their personal connections to those characters would be, and a lot of it involved me just listening to them because they have amazing imaginations and they're pretty brilliant people. Mm. They taught me a lot about what the characters were, and you know, on set I tried not to get in their way. You know, I mean, it was the type of thing where their instincts were generally right. I mean, if I wanted to push them in a different direction, but once we were on the same page about the script, once we were on, you know, and we knew what the characters wanted in each scene, they couldn't make a wrong decision. All they were doing was giving me choices for the editing room, and that's what you get when you work with really great actors.
And Aaron is actually who I envisioned while we were writing the script, which I think, I don't know if that is a testament to The Secret or something, but it's very bizarre that he's who was actually cast, because, you know, I didn't want to imagine a person when I was writing it, but for some reason that's who kept popping into my head, and so that he's doing it and that he is just awesome in the movie, it blows my mind.
So what was the hardest thing about this picture?
The hardest thing, we worked on a tight schedule, you know, I mean, it was pretty much from the time we were in pre-production till the time we locked picture, I didn't have a day off. I mean, so there was, I guess, a lack of time to step away and get sort of objectivity and distance. There was no distance. I mean, it was living it for the latter part of, you know, for the past 6 months or so, this has been my life, and I have had nothing else, and I have a wife who I'm grateful to, who's you know, been willing to put up with me during that time. I mean, I think it's nice sometimes to be able to breathe. I think there's, in the same way that this relationship in the film is sort of all-consuming and obsessive.
Right.
I've been, I mean, I, good God, for the past 4 months, I've been waking up each day, not intentionally, around 4 or 5 a.m. with a nightmare involving this dream and thinking I'm late to set or thinking that I made a mistake in the editing or something like that. And, you know, it's nice to now to start to have a little bit of distance and let the audience have a dialogue and relationship with the film that may be very different than what, I don't know, I intended.
So did you sit in the theater the other night when the movie went?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, and I'll be there. We're screening in Park City tonight, and I'll be there as well.
So what was that feeling for you?
It was great. I mean, I think I, you know, I wasn't nervous during the day. There was the great feeling of like, well, I can't screw it up any more than I've already screwed it up. Like, it's done. They have, you know, Sundance has it. It is what it is. And then about an hour before, I started getting a feeling in my gut that was I had to like puke and shit at the same time. And I was like, I need to go into a dark, quiet place and just not be around people. And I was, as soon as I actually like walked into the theater, you know, it was pretty exciting. I mean, I think I was like this for the first hour and didn't quite move. But people laughed. People laughed, you know, within the first minute of the film.
More than you expected or about the hope for?
Yeah, much more than I expected. I mean, we know, you know, I know the script that we wrote really well, and I know the film that was edited, and I know the moments that are supposed to be ha moments, that are supposed to be ha 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 moments. I know the moments where I'd like people to be stone cold silent. You know, a lot of that's intellectual. I know the moments that I intended that.
Right.
Never screened the film. The biggest screening we'd ever had was for 30 people. Laughter certainly is infectious, and when you do that without a group, it's a very different thing. So, yeah, it was very funny, and it was amazing to see that people were really moved by it.
I think that's a real testament to what people can handle, too, like what audiences can handle, because, you know, talking to people about, you know, the subject matter of the film, people say, like, oh, a film about alcoholism, like, people don't want to see that. People are uncomfortable with that. And then that right away, people were laughing at the things that, I mean, I thought were funny, but, you know, who knows, like, if people would get it or connect to that, and that all throughout the film, that there was way more laughter than I expected. I think that's a real testament to, like, it wasn't entirely an audience of alcoholics, but, you know, that people from all walks of life could relate to it and find the humor in it.
So, well, you both found something that was more accessible than alcoholism. Alcoholism.
Yeah.
Alcoholism as well.
Yes. I mean, that was certainly the goal. I mean, we didn't know. I think our sense of humor, I mean, we don't like gags. We don't like jokes for a punchline. But I think our sense of humor, the thing that if we were never going to show something to the world, it would probably be pretty dark. And I mean, we certainly, I don't know, we find getting drunk and smoking crack to be pretty funny. But it's also because it's something that's not, it's not something we laugh at from afar. It's something that I think, right, in a pretty firsthand way, we're like, oh yeah, that's something that you kind of, you're on your worst days, it's like, yeah, you've been there. I don't think I knew exactly whether an audience in, you know, in Park City, Utah, would gawk at that or be horrified by that, or if we've just reached a point where it's like, yep, that's where we are, and we'll still go with the character and still identify. And I was so pleased to see that, yeah, that's where we are, and audiences will go with you. And
now you have to find out from audiences in Wisconsin. And
yeah,
exactly.
Hopefully, yeah.
In our home states of Wyoming and Georgia. Yeah.
Well, my aunt's friend from Lake Okoboji, Iowa, was there at the screening. She came up and introduced me herself to me and said that she's a friend of my Aunt Pat. So she loved it.